Hey, welcome to the New Schools Podcast. Today's guest is an award-winning cyber technology and cyber education expert. She is none other than Mikhail Leshem, one of the co-founders and the current head of school at Acton Academy, Bergen County in New Jersey. After working for more than 15 years in cyber intelligence, Mikhail pursued her dream of becoming an educator. She got her master's degree in education while co-founding Israel's National Cyber Education Center. Through her research, she learned about Acton's approach to learning and education and fell in love with it. She started as a part-time guide in Acton Academy, Verona, before leading the development of Acton Academy, Bergen County in New Jersey. Mikhail is also the co-author of the Exploring Twins book series, an original book series for children grades K through 4 who love to read and explore science, and she is also a proud mother of 4 wonderful boys. This episode is a chat between two good friends. Shannon and Mikhail talk about the main reasons they chose Acton Academy as a school model, the challenging adjustment period for kids who came from traditional learning environments, the importance of vulnerability and a growth mindset, and why guides do not answer questions. And now here's your host, Shannon Falkenstein, chatting with Mikhail Leshem.
So I'm Shannon Falkenstein, and I'm the founder and executive director of Acton Academy and Montessori in El Salvador in Central America. And tell me your name.
So my name is Mikhail Leshem. I am one of the co-founders and the head of school of Acton Academy of Bergen County, New Jersey.
Nice. And you were at, you were with Kai, right?
So I worked with Kai for a year in Verona. And then after this year, we opened our Acton. So, yeah.
Okay. So tell me a little bit about your background, like your origin story. How did you get here?
So I started my career actually in Israel, in the intelligence force, in the army. And I served there for 13 years, something like this, in the technology area. I was a team leader and a project leader, and it was fascinating and very interesting. And we had a big project that we were working on, and after we got this huge prize for it, I decided this is the time for me to resign and move on to the next adventure. And so I went to pursue my master degree in education, and I was teaching in a democratic school in Israel, which is, it has some elements that are similar to Acton. It's also progressive, but it's also had a lot of differences. And after, I was supposed to continue the journey and walk on the principal path, basically, and then we moved here to the United States. We moved here 5 years ago. We moved basically because of my partner's job. And when we came here, I was, I didn't know anything about the American education system. So my kids went to public schools and I learned the system for a while. And after the first 2 years, I understood that I'm looking for something different, both for them and also for me. And I started to look for all kind of alternatives for me for the beginning. So I went to explore all kind of different alternative education systems in our area. So we have Waldorf, and we have co-ops, and we have Sudbury School, which is very interesting model. Yeah, so I went and I've been in each institute for a few weeks, and I learned a lot. That was really very, very interesting. And that's how I found Acton, kind of like as part of this research. And I think I found it, and then the same night I completed reading Laura's book. And the next morning I called Kai and I told him, I want to come. I want to be a guide in your Acton. And that's how it all began. So
nice. So tell me, like, what were the top two or three things that made you say, yes, this is Acton is right? Because you really, wow, you really explored a lot of different options very deeply and, you know, really hands-on, getting in there, checking it out. That's amazing. Yes. So what made the big difference with Acton?
So I think the first thing I really, really liked was the fact that this is a learner-driven community, which also resonates with the Sudbury philosophy, but it's also very structured. So the combination between the fact that it's a learner-driven community, but also very structured, this is something that I never seen nowhere else, and I was fascinated by. I think that's an amazing thing in Acton. I think this is, I don't think, like, it's hard to understand it sometimes at the beginning, but I feel this is so important for the learners, the fact that it's structured, and the fact that they have a lot of freedom, and actually freedom and structure are not the opposites. So that's the first thing. And I think the second thing is that it combines a lot of elements that I believe are truly important for 21st century education. So the fact that we use, for example, online platforms for core skills, this is something that today when I go into regular classroom and I see a teacher teaches math for 20 kids at the same right. level, it is so weird. I mean, yeah, why are we doing it?
It makes
why,
no sense.
Why are we doing it like this? It's so weird, right? Each one yeah. of them has their own pace. And so that's one element. And also project-based learning, which I really knew well from the Waldorf approach. And I think this is a great, great way to learn, which combines all kind of topics and very hands-on. So this is an element I really liked. So I think Acton for me was a combination of all the elements I really liked from all the methods.
Yeah.
So that was fascinating for me. So I fell in love, really. I read Laura's book and that's it. I found my way.
That's great. That's amazing. Yeah, I had heard of Acton and I had sort of, this was in like 2000, I don't know, 14 or 13. And I had like, you know, when you like write stuff down on a piece of paper, like I need to look into that, you know? And it just was there and I would see it and I would never throw it away, but I hadn't looked at it. And then one time my husband and I were at this anniversary big dinner somewhere. And I was reading like the bios of the people that were going to be there. And it one stuck out at me and it was Acton Academy, Guatemala. And I was like, oh, there it is. I think everyone needs to, you know, to investigate. And that night at the dinner, I went and found Juan Mauricio Bonifaci, who's the owner of Acton Guatemala. And I was like, I got to talk to you about your school. Like, tell me. And we just started talking. And yeah, within 90 minutes, it was like, that's it. Everything you said was exactly what I want. And I went that night and applied. So I think when you fall really hard for it.
I know.
I hear you. It combines so many different things. So great. So tell me about your kids. How many kids do you have?
So I have 4 boys.
Wow.
And each one of them is a whole different story. My oldest one, Ori, he is almost 12 and he didn't join Acton last year because we had only elementary school and he decided to go to the middle school in his the public school middle school. And actually he was really upset about the experience there. So he plans to move to our middle school next year on this coming September. We're opening middle school and he's supposed to be the first student.
Congratulations.
That's really exciting. And then I have 2 boys. Shahar is 10 years old and Zohar is 8 years old. And both of them were part of our elementary studio. And I have Yali, who is 4 years old, and he really wants to join. But as for now, it feels like he's too young, so he will wait 1 more year before he will join Spark Studio.
Ah, great.
So, yeah.
Great. Yes. And how many learners do you have coming in the fall?
So that's actually a good question. We last year we had 14 learners. We started with 13, and we ended up with 14, which was great. And next year we plan to expand to Spark Studio, which we plan to have between 10 to 12. So we have 10 enrolled and we have a lot of people on the enrollment process. I think I want to keep it small because I feel like when we build the foundations, I want to start small and then grow. So it's going to be around 10 to 12 students on the Spark Studio, and we'll have something like 17 learners on the elementary studio. And I hope we have at least 3 middle schoolers to start with Ori. It's supposed to be very small middle school. So because it's all of them are supposed to come from outside, and middle school is tough age to start something so new like ACTON, we want to start it very, very small.
I hear
you. So we're supposed to have something like 30. It's very exciting.
Wow, that is really exciting. Excellent. So, okay. So I wanted to ask this first, but how are you doing in COVID? How's your COVID reality treating you?
Oh my God. I think the best word to describe it is adjusting. I think at the beginning I was like, okay, this is going to end very soon. So, you know, we just have to make sure we're okay. And this is going to be end very soon. And now I feel like this is not going to end. Not soon, maybe not ever. So we're adjusting to this new reality. I think I can find a lot of good things that came up with COVID, which is, you know, and I learned to enjoy them. And I think that I also find a lot of challenges, which I have to learn how to overcome. So it's both of them. I think it's a mix.
Yeah. Well, tell me 3 great things.
The first thing is that all our family is not here in the U.S. We have most of our family is actually in Israel. And we were supposed to go to Israel in April, and then we, you know, postponed it to July, and now we just canceled everything. But because of this, we actually talk with them much more. So we had birthday parties on Zoom. And I have like a date with my sisters on Zoom every couple of weeks. And I think that because everybody is doing it, like it became something more makes sense to do. And we didn't do it before. So that was very, very nice. Second thing I think is very obvious, but I get to spend a lot of time, much more time with our family. So my partner, he used to go a lot on trips for his work. He used to go almost every week for a few days, and now he's not going anywhere. He's just working from home. And that's really nice for all of us. So that's a big change, and it's a good change for all of us. And I think the last thing is that there are so many amazing online resources you can actually learn from, which is so great. So for example, the whole Montessori approach is something that I was really familiar with, but right now there are a lot of courses that I can just take online. They used to be, you know, in person, and right now it's everything on Zoom. So that's really nice. Or I am going to do this entrepreneurship course for young adults, which also was in person. It was supposed to be a camp, but right now it's an online camp. So my kids can join it. So all kind of online resources that used to be like either very expensive or just in person and very far from us, they're online now. And it's great.
Yeah, that's good. Well, that's good. I'm glad you're finding ways to be resourceful and connected to stay sane. So ACTON, one of the things I find really deeply meaningful and authentic about ACTON is that it's a school that really promotes entrepreneurship in deed and also in spirit. The model of the hero's journey and knowing that if anything that you're going to do that's really difficult is something that is going to follow kind of that trajectory of the hero's journey. You know, hero sets out on a path, runs into a mess of trouble, has to grow him or herself extremely in order to reach success. And then finally, you know, reaches the success with the help of mentors and fellow travelers and things like that. And then returns home bearing a gift that will expand their community. And I think that entrepreneurship can be such an incredible hero's journey. And as owners, we're involved in education with our kids and we're parents, but then we're also on this entrepreneurship journey. And it can be really hard, you know, I don't know if you relate to that, but it can be really hard. So many skills that we have to learn. So given that setup, like, tell us a little bit about, like, what have been the hardest moments or the hardest things that you've had to go through on this journey so far?
So I had tons of them. Like, I really have tons of stories, but I have a very major one that this is the one that every time someone asks me, what was the hardest thing you had to do? So this pops up. We started our journey on January 2019, and we were supposed to open Acton on September 2021. So we didn't mean to open on September 2020 at all. It wasn't the plan. So we were doing this first parents' night. When we talked about our plans, we didn't have location. We had nothing, basically nothing. So just a couple of parents came, and it was a very nice evening. We brought some food. It was around June 19, and we planned to take the summer off and then just, you know, start working on it again on September, and we plan to have the whole year just for preparation. And then 2 weeks after, we found this amazing location, and the location was like, it looks perfect for a school. And I know that finding location is the hardest part, right?
Can be, yeah.
Because the zoning, the regulation, it has to be industrial, whatever, blah, 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 blah. So I went to this location and I told the broker, that's a perfect location, but I need it for a year from now. And he told me, nobody's going to keep it for you for a year, right? So I said, okay, so you know what? I'll come back to you. And we said, okay, let's try to talk to the parents that came and asked them if it's relevant to open this year. Like, I'm telling you, what was I thinking? I'm looking at this now and it seems like insane. So we talked to those parents. It was a group of five or six families. And some of them were telling us we want it now. We think it's amazing. We want it for our kids. That could be an amazing opportunity. So we went back to the broker and we said, okay, we're ready to go and let's start to work on it. And it looked like amazing. It looked like a miracle. Everything looked good. And then 2 weeks after, at the middle of July, the broker called me and said, the owner doesn't want to rent you anything. He doesn't. And I was like, that's it. Oh. I'm done. That's it. I mean, how can I talk to those parents and explain them? What will I say? Like, they will never trust me again. That's it. That's the end of this journey. I was sure about that. And I talked to my partner, Shira. She is the co-founder with me. And we decided the first thing we have to do is talk to the parents. And we made this conversation. It was the hardest conversation I ever done in my life. That's for sure. I was almost crying in each one of them. And I told them we will try to find a different location, but I knew the market very well. And I knew it's almost impossible to find a location in 5 weeks. I mean, it was the middle of July and September 1st, it's the beginning of the year. So we told them we were going to take one more week and then we'll give up and just, and I was definitely ready to give up. I was calling one of the moms and I just talked about it on the end of the year celebration. I called her and I was about to tell her that I'm giving up, that I tried and this is like, there are just no locations and you cannot find anything in 5 weeks. And she was so strict with me. She told me, look, Michal, you promised us, you cannot quit. No matter what, you cannot quit. And I was like, but what can I do? And she was like, those kids are waiting for you. And you promised us you cannot quit right now. And this is so funny because she's not like this. She's not this type of personality for this conversation, but the specific conversation for me, she had to, you know, tell me you have to do it. And then the day after, another mom from the founding family sent me an email and told me, look, St. Mary Church, they want to rent two rooms in their building. They have two rooms available in the school building. Maybe that could work for you. And 2 weeks after, we had a signed contract. And that the perfect location because it was already a school. So all the regulations were very easy. You know, all the zoning approval and the COO, everything was very easy to, but I told all the parents the fact that they were, that, that you know, that they didn't quit and that they didn't say after this experience, okay, we don't want to have nothing to do with this lady because she promised something and then she just changed her mind. So that was really an amazing experience for me. And those families, we had them for the whole year and they are staying with us for next year. And that was really, so definitely the hardest event I had, but also I grew a lot from this because, they had so much faith in the way and so much faith in me and they didn't even know me so well. I mean, we talked twice or three times before, that's it. So, yeah.
Wow. Those sound like really great acting families, willing to take a risk.
Yes.
To do something that they really are excited about and that they really believe in. Which brings me to my next question. Are you a big fan of Brené Brown?
Oh, wow.
Love Brené Brown. So Brené writes in Daring Greatly and in Braving the Wilderness that showing up and living an authentic life, even when you have to risk belonging, is the mark of someone who really leads a wholehearted life. And so I think I have felt that way so often on my acting journey that it does risk your belonging. You're doing something very different. And even now, for more than 4 years into it, I start to understand how foundational school is to society. And that when you opt to do something very different, that you're choosing to kind of live outside of that a little bit, and that can be thrilling and it can be challenging and it can be a little bit scary and very rewarding. But tell me a little bit about you, like how have you felt with that sentiment of daring greatly and braving the wilderness to do something totally different?
Wow. I mean, I think the first thing for me is that I'm not from here. So I came from Israel 5 years ago, and I think, and we opened the Acton 4 years ago, 1 year ago. So after I've been here for 4 years, and I think that being able to stand there and say, I think we need to do something different, even though I'm not from here and I'm not as familiar maybe as you are with the public system, or, you know, and still say, I truly believe we need to do something different. That's super hard. And I remember that I was walking to take my kids from public school. And it was after we post all the posts on Facebook and we started to talk with parents, and it was hard for me to talk with the moms of the PTO, of our PTO, or, you know, because I felt like I am doing something against them in somehow. And I think the more I got to understand that there are all kind of different ways, and that's totally okay that someone will be very happy with the public school. And also it's totally okay that someone will be very happy with Acton, and both of them are okay. I think the better I felt with myself, knowing that I'm following my path and that's, you know, that where I go, and also not trying to convince other people to come to our Acton. I think this is also a lesson I learned. I'm not trying to convince anyone. I'm trying to, you know, explain what we're doing, but if it's not the right fit for you, I don't want to convince you, because then it's not going to work. It's either you want to do it and then you want to try it and you believe in those things, or you don't believe it. And then that's okay. That's perfect. So you have your own path. But I think that when I try to convince people that we are the right way or they should come to us, it always ends up with families that are not a good fit. The families that are a good fit are families that, you know, you explain them and then it feels right for them. Not the one that you need to explain them and to convince them and answer questions that seem like, why is it better than something else?
How do you tell me, like, if I was a new family and, you know, I was a family and I was, you know, somewhere we ran into one another and I said, you know, hey, like, what do you do? Or what, tell me where your kids go to school. What, how do you open? Like, what's your elevator pitch, or what's your kind of opener?
The first thing I always say is that Acton is a learner driven community, meaning that we believe that the learner can take ownership on their learning, and we want to build an environment that will enable them to do it. So if you are a mother that believes that you should tell your kid what to do every second of the day, you should lead his path, you should create his journey and exactly give him instructions for every small part of his life, that's not a good fit. Mm-hmm. We truly believe that the students, the learners can lead their own learning and can make very important choices about their life. So that's one thing. And I always also say that we truly believe that each learner has his or her own pace, and that they should, you know, work in their own pace, meaning sometimes this pace could be much faster than the regular pace or much slower, but that's their pace and we respect that. And also something really important that I always say, and that's hard for families to understand sometimes, is that the choice should be also the learner's choice and not also the parent, not only the parent's choice. Because some parents, I always say that, like, if the parents feel this is a very good fit for their kids, but their kids don't want to leave the public school, so that could be a problem. That might not work. So it should be a choice for the parents are doing, but also that the kids are doing, unless, like, it's a very, very young learner. So, you know, 5 years old, sometimes it's too young. And then I tend to hear more about the learner from the parents. But if it's an older learner, I will always want to talk to the learner, mm-hmm. and try to figure out how he feels or she feels. And how connected is she to the environment? How does she feel with the fact that nobody is going to spoon feed her, that she will take ownership for her learning? Is she excited about it or is she scared about it? Like, what does she like about it? So this is also something very important.
Have you, Michal, ever had the case where you've had a student come who's maybe a little bit older, maybe 10 or something? I know you don't have a middle school yet, but they come from that traditional environment and then they start at Acton and they're like, I can't function. Like, I need someone to tell me what to do. And then you've been able to either successfully help them, like, get through that difficulty and become an empowered learner or not. Do you have any experiences like that?
So we had all our students came from public schools. And we had 6 students that were 10 year old. So they're not young. They're not so young. And for some of them, it was the adjustment took some time. I think that they all chose to come, and they had, this gave them a lot of motivation. That's why I think this is so important that the learner would choose to come, because the fact that they chose to come, and they knew why they chose to come. They chose to come because there were, you know, some other issues or things in their older system that they didn't like, and they wanted something else for themselves. So that gave them a lot of motivation, but the adjustment was hard. And even the fact that guides do not answer questions, that was super hard to adjust for everyone, also for me, yeah. And definitely for them. They were constant, even like small questions. Can I go to the bathroom? Like, day after day after day after day. I mean, like, we're 6 weeks in the studio and she still asks, can I go to the bathroom? That's amazing. Mm-hmm. And I'm not talking about more complicated questions. So I think we didn't have the experience of a learner that didn't fit, so he had to leave because of that. But we definitely had some learners, girls and boys, that it took them some time to adjust. And we had to be very consistent with why we're doing it. Always talking about the why. Laura told me that at the beginning of my experience at Acton, I called her and we had this 1 hour mentoring that they're doing, Laura and Jeff. And she told me, always talk about the why. The why is so important, because when they understand why you're not asking questions, it makes it easier to try to cooperate with that.
Mm-hmm. That's great. And tell me, let's talk about that. Tell, because obviously not all the listeners are going to know. Tell us more about why guides don't ever answer questions. Tell us the why.
Yeah. So guides do not answer questions. I think the main idea for me is that the learners get to count on themselves and on their peers more and more if the guides do not answer questions. And when you're not answering questions, they have to figure out the answers. So sometimes they have to figure it out themselves, and that's nice. Most of the time they don't figure it out themselves, and then they need to figure out what to do. And then they either go to the peers or they come back to the guides, and we give them options for how can they figure out the question. And I think for our learners, going to the peers and ask for help was one of the biggest lessons they learned this year. For all of them, it was super hard. For some of them, it was hard because they were shy and they just didn't know how to ask for help from a peer. And for some of them, they felt like if they're asking for help, it means they're not smart, or it means that they're not good enough. So they have to figure it out by themselves. And all of this is all fixed mindset. This is part of, you know, exactly the change we want them to do. So, and it was very hard for me not to answer questions. So we did this contest between me and my guide, and they counted our questions, and I always lost, but at least I improved. So that was good. And they were trying to trick me and ask me like those small questions that they knew like I would answer. That was really funny. But I think the more we were consistent with it, the more they took ownership on actually figuring out the answers themselves.
That's great. That's great. Yeah, I really relate to that. We've done those contests too. They're fantastic. Yep. The kids have a lot of fun with it. So, okay. So what would you say is your superpower?
So that's a really good question. I think I have two, but one is really maybe the most important one, is that I am really a positive person. So okay. I tend to always find the good things, even when it's like super hard and there is almost nothing good. And then it really helps me not to give up. I think it's connected, like they're both connected. I could, even when something seems almost impossible or in a really, really hard situation, I will find the good things and I will try to move on and not give up on them. And I think this is helpful.
That is really helpful. That's a big part of resilience, I think. So I want to circle back. When you were talking about meeting, you know, let's say meeting a parent and then first telling them it's a learner-driven community, and then going on a little bit further with that and asking the parent if they believe that they should be in charge of the child's educational journey, it made me think about college. And I remember, you know, when I was growing up, I'm 48. So when I was growing up, it was like, there was just no question. Like you were going to college, which college were you going to? You were trying to get into the best one. The Ivy Leagues were the, you know, that was the real big goal. If you didn't get in, you like, you weren't good enough. That was the kind of mindset that we all had. And then I met my husband and, you know, now we're into the 2000s and he and I are having some kind of a conversation, and he said something to me about like, well, if our kids even go to college. And I was like, are you crazy? I was like, who are you? Like, what do you mean if they even go to college? And he's like, well, I mean, think about it. Like, look how expensive college is now. And for the amount of money you would spend on college, like you could invest that in a business or something. And that was like the first time that I had ever considered that. And I thought he had three heads. And then, you know, a couple of years later, I started being like, you know, questioning the whole college model too. And then now with COVID and all that, you know, are people even going back to college in the fall? What's going to happen? the prices of college is just, wow, we're just way out of proportion to what you can hope to earn when you first enter the job market and things like that. So when it, tell me more about your journey with that. You know, you have four kids, like what is your kind of prognosis of the future with college? Are you still pushing college? Are you a big question mark? Like, does it feel scary? I think it feels a little scary. Mm-hmm.
So I think well, as I said, I'm not from here. I didn't grow up in America. In Israel, it's kind of the same with university. You go to the army and then you go to university. And like most people go to university, that's the regular path. And the first time I thought that this might not be such a good idea was actually when I was in the army. I was in the cyber technology area. And my soldiers, they were very young. They were not come from university. We just took them for high school and we trained them.
So they were like 19, 20?
Yeah, 18, 19. So we trained them to be programmers and cyber technology people. And when they left the army, they found amazing jobs in the high-tech industry without going to the university for 1 second, right? Mm-hmm, mm-hmm. And for the high-tech companies, those soldiers were much, much, much better than people who came from the university because they had experience of 3 years of actually working.
Yeah.
So those students from the university, they came to the high-tech companies without any experience. They waited for someone to teach them what to do, and the high-tech companies, they just didn't want them. And for me, that was really eye-opening because I understood that there is a problem with the system. Mm-hmm. You pay a lot of money, you go there for 3 or 4 years, you're supposed to learn something, and then you go to the market and you don't have what the market needs. And I think for me, that was the beginning of when I understood that each person can really find their own path. And sometimes this path has nothing to do with college or university. I think for my own kids, I really don't care. I really want them to find their calling and find what they want to do in the world. I have to say that I will find it very weird if all four of them will go to college, because I mean, I'm not sure I understand why. Some of them, so my son is already coding and he's only 10, so he will be a very good coder when he'll be 18. I'm not sure why he needs to go to learn and to spend so much money if that's what he wants to do. So if he decides that that's what he wants to do. Or the same thing with like my, so it really depends. I think higher education could be a good path for some people and for some, for example, if you want to be a researcher and you want to, you know, work in this field to explore those things, so that makes sense path. But if you want to do something that it doesn't help you so much, and I think that this whole COVID-19 situation will make a lot of things change in this area. I really hope so, at least. Okay. Yeah, because I think that if it will not change, that will be a big waste. I think it should change a lot of things.
I agree.
So I'm really happy with the fact that in Acton, we don't have a Launchpad yet, right? Because we only opened middle school this year, but I'm really happy that there is another different path that is not college that you can choose.
And have you started having those conversations with parents?
Nope, not yet, because we are getting only very young learners. They're not there yet. I think some of our families are thinking in this direction and they have those thoughts in mind that maybe, because some of them, you know, took different paths themselves in their life, but we're not there yet. Our learners are quite young. So I guess like if next year we'll open middle school, I think the year after we'll start working on figuring out what Launchpad seems to look like, and then we'll start staying in this direction.
Nice, okay. Thank you. So, okay. So now I'm going to run through some kind of either or questions. Some relate specifically to Acton. So I remember last year, my guides went to, some of my guides went to Texas for the training in Irving at the Humanist Academy. And the overarching question of the training weekend was, which is more important, preparation or mindset? What do you think?
Mindset.
Tell me why.
I think that if you have the right mindset, I think preparations are super important. I'm not saying not, but they can get you so far. The rest, you just cannot prepare to. And then if you don't have the right mindset, if you don't understand that failure is always an option, and that if something didn't work out, so you should try something else and instead of giving up. And that if something that you did was a complete disaster, it doesn't mean you are a complete disaster. It just means that this was a complete disaster, which are not the same thing. I think definitely mindset. I think the more we walk in this path, the more growth I can see in the mindset. I think you cannot learn it just from reading on it, right? You have to actually walk in the path and then fail completely. and from this place of completely failure, stand up and say, okay, I'm ready to try again. I know it was horrible and I know I made the wrong decision, but I'm ready to try again and try something else. And that's only mindset. So I think definitely mindset.
Thank you. Okay, next one. Intelligence or grit? Which one do you think is more valuable?
Again, grit. I think intelligence is important. It's also, well, it depends how you define intelligence. Jeff always talks about it. But I think grit is what makes you actually be able to do something with the intelligence you have. You can be, you know, you can be smart. Something can be easier for you or not, but it doesn't matter. The moment, and there will be the moment when something is hard. And then if you don't have the grit to keep on doing it, to keep on walking, to try again, to do the hard work. Even if you're very smart, you have to do the hard work. Hard work is completely disconnected from being smart or from intelligence. Even like saying being smart, I'm not sure I agree with this, because I think that you're getting smarter as you work on something, and it's not about how much IQ you have. It's about what can you actually do when you're walking your path and finding those monsters. And I think the monsters of the hero's journey, always in Acton, we talk about the distracting monster, victimhood and resistance.
Yeah.
And I feel working with those monsters, and each time it's a different monster. Each time for me, sometimes each day it could be a different monster, sometimes with each challenge. Every time, in order to fight those monsters, intelligence doesn't help at all.
Yes.
No intelligence help you when you find.
In fact, it could be your worst enemy, the intelligence.
Exactly. No intelligence helps you when you're being victimhood and you just blame everyone else. It doesn't help you that you're smart.
You can be very clever at building a case and blaming. And
yes, exactly. Exactly. So I think the grit is what actually makes it possible to fight those monsters and understand that that's the thing. The thing is not fighting them and then this is it. You have to just redo it again and again. It's like a spiral, and you just always go a little bit forward and then meet the new challenge.
You know, I think when I first started learning about growth mindset through Acton, and when I first started reading Carol Dweck's research about about when you define someone as intelligent, then their actions are all about defending that self-identity instead of actually learning more. And then I think that around the time that I was learning that I heard that in Asian countries, like in the Eastern kind of side of the world, they don't have this concept of you're not good at math. Whereas like we grew up with, and so I wanted to ask you, as growing up in a different culture than I did, that, you know, I had definitely a self-concept by about eighth grade that I was not good at math. And then later when I was studying to get into graduate school, I rededicated myself to math and I was teaching it to myself. And I realized I am actually good at math and I just needed to work and I had to have it presented a different way and go at my pace and, you know, all that, which I think is wonderful because Acton, that's what it does, is self-paced learning on your, you know, self-directed learning. So did you grow up with that concept in Israel also of there's good at math or not good at math? Or was it more like that, like what I believe is in Asian cultures, which is like, what do you mean you're not good at math? It just means you haven't worked hard enough at math.
Israel is very similar to the United States in a lot of aspects, and definitely in this one. I think in Israel, like here, and I used to work a lot with the whole problem of specific girls and STEM. Mm-hmm. And I feel that maybe the most fundamental problem there is this concept that girls from very, very, very young age are treated like they're not good on STEM. It's not only math, it's also science, right? And technology and engineering.
Yeah.
And there are tons of research that shows that teachers talk to girls different than they talk to boys. They ask them different questions and then they just assume they don't know anything. And the girls just absorb it and assume that they're not good in math and that's it. And I think that, so my own experience was very different because my father was, an engineer. He came from, to Israel from Georgia, from Russia, mm-hmm. like on a very old age, like, I'm 37 years old, which is quite old. And we are three girls. I have two sisters. So he was the biggest believer that we have to learn physics and math and to be the best in physics and math. So it has a lot of disadvantages because that's what I absorbed at home. Uh-huh. But for sure, I think one of the only three girls in my physics class in high school. We were only three girls, like not a few took it. And of course, I learned bioengineering for my first degree, and we had like not a lot of girls. And I think this is something that goes on and on for ages and for a lot of generations. And the only way to change it is actually working with girls' mindset, understanding there is no such thing as not good at math. There is no such thing as physics is hard. You just if you want it and you're interested in it, you have to work hard, put the effort, and then you'll excel. Maybe, you know, the beginning point is a little bit easier for some people or harder for other people. It doesn't matter. You just need to try. And I think with the female learners in our studio, I saw this change happening this year. And that was so great because some of them, they came from public school and they were, you know, 10 years old. It's quite old. So they all thought that they're bad in math and they didn't like it. And the more they got into self-learning and you know, teach themselves math, they were able to see that this is actually, it's all in their hands and it's their choice how to look at this and then, you know, what to do with it. So I think this is really super. And growth mindset, this is such an important concept. I wish everybody in the world and in every school would have to work just with, you know, only this would change the world.
Yeah, I agree. And we, another thing I think I noticed, and tell me if your acting mirrors this, is that when you learn math in a group, like you were talking about in the beginning with all the students sitting in desks and the teacher teaching from the chalkboard, and some are lost and some are bored and some are right, you know, very few are right in the middle. And it makes you sort of self-conscious about your math or about anything that you're learning, right? Whereas the learner-driven, where, you know, my kids have, my daughter's like never been in a different system besides Acton. So she has never had that experience of feeling embarrassed about not being able to do the math problem or being called on when she's not paying attention and being sort of lost. So I think her brain doesn't go into that fight or flight mode when she needs to come, you know, when she needs to produce something out of her mind. Internally, she just assumes that she has time, space, patience in order to do that. And that by the very nature of not triggering that amygdala, she can stay online and figure things, you know, online in her mind and figure things out. And I think that's such a blessing that is almost hidden, but that I think all of the Acton learners have. Do you find that also in your studio?
So I think it's only been our first year, and almost half of it was online, which was very, very different experience the regular experience. And even with all those, having said that, I think they made so much growth in this area. I think that they are actually capable of understanding that they are responsible for their own journey. So no, if they don't understand something, they need to figure out, either to figure out themselves or ask for the specific help they need. And for example, a lot of times it happened that they asked someone for help and he really didn't help them.
Right.
And then they just quit and they tried themselves again and they were just stuck. And then I reflected on them and I asked, so what can you do if this person cannot help you? So what are your options? And understanding that going to a different learner and ask them is an option, that was completely new for them. I mean, this was something, and you know, some students explain things better than others. And some, and we had a lot of cases when the younger students actually taught math the older students, which was amazing to see because they're very, you know, close in the age. So sometimes the younger students are much more progressed than the older students. So for the older students to actually be able to accept help from a younger learner, that's a big thing.
Yeah, I love
That's hard. And when they learn to do it, they actually are able to understand something that they didn't understand before. So I think taking responsibility and taking ownership on their own learning, this is the biggest growth they did this year. Even with the corona, which was definitely much more complicated than in the studio.
That's amazing. Thank you. Okay, so final question. So a couple of years ago at an owner's conference, Jeff, the founder, co-founder of the Acton Network, and Juan Mauricio Bonifaci, who started, I think, the second or third Acton ever in Guatemala, they had a wonderful debate about about two different kind of models or attitudes of their Actons. And Jeff characterizes Acton Maine in Austin, the first ever Acton, as having a Navy SEAL model, where if you you got to be given your 100% best all the time, or like, why are you even here? And then Juanma talks about how his is more like a family, where you can mess up over and over again and you're always welcome, and that you, but they of course expect incremental improvement. Where do you fall on that sort of gradient?
So I definitely fall in the family attitude much more, but what I want to add is that I feel as long as the learner chooses to be part of it, so he's welcome. I think that's the most, for me, that made a difference this year, because you can, sometimes I think that they didn't give their 100% all the time. I'm not sure anybody can give their 100% all the time. I didn't see anybody like that, but that's, Navy SEAL, maybe they do, but definitely, they had their own mistakes. They had their own bad days. They failed so many times, but every time it came back to these basic questions: do you want to be part of it or no? And if you want to be part of it, what can we do now together in order to make this experience better? And I think that choosing this again and again, understanding that I want to be part of it, and there, if I want to be part of it, so there are some rules I need to follow. And if I want to be part of it, I cannot do whatever I want. And if I want to be part of it, even though meditation is so hard for me, and I'm trying to do it for 6 months now, and I'm still getting distracted, I will try it one more time today. So choosing this again and again and again, that's what made the difference for us. And I think the more, and family is a very good example for that, because I feel like in family, it's very similar. I felt they were kind of a big tribe, a big family to one another. And they helped each other in a way that when they failed, or when they felt like they cannot take it anymore, some other peers and learners came up and helped them stand up again, by reminding them why they're here and what they were able to achieve so far. So, and when they saw it, so they chose to try one more time, and they of course were able to do it. I think I definitely, and I didn't tell them this, I definitely think that being in your 100% all the time, this is not the experience we had, definitely, this past year. But I do think that we saw so much growth. And even though there were some days that they came in 20% or 10% or 0%, they were able to, you know, come back and bring their 100%. And that's what matters. So
nice. Thank you. Well, I think I'll conclude we've gone an hour, so I'm going to conclude our official podcast here. But I wanted to, I didn't want this to be about me. I wanted it to be so much more about you, but there were two things that really resonated with me that I just wanted to connect with you on. The first year that we opened, we had the same thing. We found the perfect house. We were planning on opening. We were starting camp in July, and then we would start the full year in August. And we had a house lined up. It was the perfect house and we loved it. And I was traveling because I live in El Salvador, but I'm from the United States. So I'm also in a different culture than my original culture. And I could feel it, like something was wrong. We were in St. Louis for the summer and the guy was just being really, like, you know, cagey and sketchy and not really answering, which can happen here, even if they're not trying to back out. But anyway, so we get back here and we're literally, camp starts in like 11 days. And I got the same phone call where their broker's like, doesn't rent to you anymore. And I remember just like, I almost fainted. Literally, I like had to sit down on the couch because I almost passed out. And I'm like, I've collected like $6,000 from families for camp. Now I have to call and tell them we can't have camp. But my mother-in-law is the real estate agent and she found us the house we're in now within a couple of days. And so we were like cleaning and getting the painters in and fixing it all up. And we just did it. I worked so hard for 6 days or something like that with my partner and my husband and everyone. And then we just had it set up and we launched it. We did camp and we're still in that house. And yeah, so I can't believe we have like the same exact story.
Yes.
And then also I super relate to the being a foreigner and then being like, I want to do something different. And then feeling like, oh no, you know, defensive or critical or something, where then I feel kind of like it threatens my belonging even more or something like that. And so that's hard. So I relate to you with that and kind of building my own community within a culture that isn't mine. And then that feels sometimes like I already didn't feel like I was grounded and now I'm trying to lead. This is too hard. This is like, I don't have enough resources to do this, but still I keep going day after day and finding my way and getting stronger and stronger and stronger. So somehow it works. But when you're feeling like that, like I'm right here with you.
I will. Yeah.
We can support one another. So, wow, this has been a lovely conversation.
Thank you.
It was a great like first time of doing the podcast. So I hope people learn a lot from it and understand our model more. The podcast is aimed at any kind of micro school. Okay, Michal, awesome talking to you.
And, thank you so much. Okay, let me know what's going on with it.
Definitely, I will. Okay, take care. Bye.
Bye.
Thanks for listening to the New Schools Podcast. Tell a friend. Previous episodes and show notes, including any books or websites our guests recommend, can be found at thenewschools.com. If you're a parent who is looking for a new school for your family, send us a message. We would love to help. We can answer questions, share the resources we have, and help you get in touch with people in your area who are on the same path, determined to provide their kids with the best education. It's wildly important work. Thank you for doing it, and we'll see you next time.